Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian McCollum, and today we are taking a look at the only 45 caliber pattern pistol manufactured by the High Standard Company. This is, well, it's not even really a named pistol. This is the High Standard 45, which is a direct evolution of the Grant Hammond 45, which we have an example of here to compare to the High Standard gun. Basically, the Grant Hammond was a pistol that was developed by a guy named Grant Hammond for U.S. military trials during World War I. So he started patenting elements of this in 1915. It did go through military testing. The U.S. military was willing to take a look at it and, in fact, compared it to the 1911 as a baseline, and also to Remington's M53, which is basically a 45 caliber version of the Pedersen delayed blowback system. And they ended up adopting neither of them, sticking with the 1911, and none of these guns went on to have any future development. However, there's a little bit of a footnote, and that's where we get the High Standard gun. The designer of, well, Grant Hammond, the designer, apparently was a friend of a guy named Gus Swebelius, or Carl Gustav Swebelius, who would go on to found the High Standard Company. And it's not entirely clear to me where the two of them met, but it appears that Hammond took his design to High Standard in the hopes of turning it into a commercial product. And High Standard made probably two of them, or at least two that we know about, and then the project went nowhere else. So clearly this wasn't a gun, it wasn't a successful design, but we get to take a look at how High Standard attempted to turn this into a commercial gun. So let's take a look. It may not have come across in that previous shot, but this is a pretty beefy, big, chunky pistol. Definitely larger than the 1911. The predecessor, the Grant Hammond, was reputed to be actually very accurate in Army testing, and it had the interesting side feature of automatically ejecting the magazine upon firing of your last shot, which is kind of neat. It is unclear to me whether the High Standard also had that feature. I don't see anything in the mechanism that would really support it. However, it's worth noting that there are a couple parts missing from this gun. So there's something missing here and in here. And whether that's componentry to actually, you know, automatically eject the magazine, or if it's just something like a slide release, is difficult to say. All of the photographs you see of this gun in books, which are taken decades ago, those also show these parts missing. So they've probably been missing since this gun left High Standard, because this was never actually tested by the military. Anyway, since it's been in private hands, those parts seem to have been missing. We can take a look at the markings on the barrel here, which are in very nice shape, made by the High Standard Manufacturing Company of New Haven, Connecticut, United States of America, 45 caliber and patent pending. Unfortunately, because it's just patent pending, we don't know if there are any specific new patents that Hammond filed for this pistol specifically. There are a number of them that apply to the original Grant Hammond pistol. If we compare the High Standard to the Grant Hammond, you can see the obvious resemblance, but there are changes. So the takedown mechanism has changed. Safety has changed a little bit. Most significantly, the locking mechanism has actually changed substantially. So in the original Grant Hammond, there's actually a vertically traveling plunger that locks the bolt in place. On the High Standard, this has been replaced by a pivoting wedge. So you can actually see the plunger on this guy. You can see that round plug just over the hammer there. That's the plunger that locks the bolt in place when the gun's locked up. On the High Standard, I tell you what, I will just take it apart and show you what's going on inside. So this looks like a gas plug or something. This is actually just a disassembly lever. So we're gonna go ahead and rotate that 180 degrees until its flat side is facing up. Go ahead and pull the magazine out as well. There we go. Magazine's got a big old button on there that you can grab with your finger to depress the follower to help load it. Once this is rotated, then the whole upper assembly just slides right off the gun. You can see that locking flap right there, and this is in the locked position, so the bolt is locked into the slide so that when the gun fires, they'll have to travel together, which means the breech doesn't open. When I pull this back, you can see that pivoting block pivots down. As this moves backward upon firing, that block is going to be pushed down into this recess once the whole slide has traveled backward several millimeters. That's cut there just to give that locking wedge a place to go, because once it comes down, then the bolt can slide backwards. There is a recoil spring in the top of the bolt, which is held by this little plunger guy here. So if I push this in, rotate the front sight up and out of the way, like so, this is the hook that engages the spring right here. So being a short recoil gun, we've got a main spring for the bolt, which is right there, and then we also have a secondary spring to help push the whole slide assembly forward. That spring is right here, that little locking block, which, oh, that's quite a tight spring, but that's what pushes the whole slide assembly forward. Now, going back to this guy, to disassemble it, we just need to hold this block down, and then we can pull the bolt assembly out, like so. You can see the locking surfaces right here, where that locking flap goes in. There's a firing pin. It does not have a spring, or if it does, the spring is broken. This is a very sticky firing pin. There's probably some oil or gunk built up in there. But you can see this plunger is the bolt return spring. Inside here, we have a fixed ejector right there. We have our pivoting locking block right there. You can see it there from the bottom, like so. And that's pretty much it. It is interesting to me that the sight picture is actually kind of deliberately and automatically filled up partially by the locking catch, or the spring catch, on the bolt itself. So when this is in, we push that spring in, lock it in place. That's how the gun's supposed to go together. And then that sight picture is largely filled up by that spring catch. So you've got just maybe a quarter of the rear notch visible above that catch to actually center the front sight in. Kind of an interesting choice. The trigger is quite good, though, for what that's worth. Not a whole lot else going on here. We have a single action hammer fired system. Like I said, we've got what was probably either a slide release that had fitted in there. That big round slot is there to accommodate that loading button on the magazine. So when I put the magazine all the way in, that gets filled up. And then the feed lips present cartridges right up there. This does go back together just as easily as it came apart. So you just slide the upper assembly on, hold it back, rotate that 180 degrees. And presto, gun is back in service. As I mentioned earlier, there are only two known examples of the high standard 45. The first one, it appears to actually have used like repurposed Grant Hammond barrel components. This one appears to be made from the ground up, and it's the only one that has high standards name and address on the barrel. And there doesn't appear to have ever been another one. So this never went through US military testing, never went through any other formal testing that I'm aware of. This is the one gun that you normally see pictured in books. In Azell's book, you'll see this specific gun, as well as a couple others. So very cool to get a chance to take a look at it and actually take it apart and show you guys how it worked. Hopefully you enjoyed it. Thanks for watching.